So this is Hannah Jacobson Hardy. She is a community herbalist and founder of Full Moon Ghee and Sweet Birch Herbals in Ashfield. She is an herbal consultant, and she makes custom teas, holds workshops, makes a wide variety of products, including the Full Moon Ghee at the Farmers Market in Northampton. Hannah teaches occasionally at UMass. She's spoken at NOFA. She does workshops around the community and has this great herbal farm. So we are so glad to have her here today to talk about healthy fats and particularly ghee. So this is perfect timing because we just kind of wrapped that part up. So I'm going to let you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Happy to be here. It's my first time at GCC on the campus. I went to UMass Amherst, and I grew up in Northampton. And while I was at UMass, I decided to become a vegetarian for probably about 2 years, and mostly for like environmental, political reasons, because I read The Omnivore's Dilemma by Michael Pollan and was just totally appalled by the way that food was being produced and factory farmed and industrial monocropping. So I decided to eliminate meat from my diet unless I knew where it was from. And during that time, I felt terrible, to be honest. I gained weight, I got migraines, I was really stressed out. And I was tired, and I didn't want to do any schoolwork. And so it had this like complete opposite effect on my body. I thought I'd be a lot healthier. And I'm not saying that vegetarianism isn't a fine thing. I think every body is different. And my body grew up eating meat and vegetables and just a whole lot of things. And so going from that diet and lifestyle to suddenly eliminating this major part of my diet kind of put my body into shock. And I didn't know enough at the time about like how to prepare vegetarian foods and how to eat like a well-balanced kind of variety. I was eating mostly like cheese and grains and rice and pastas, and didn't know about like how to really spend and invest the time to cook vegetables. And so it was at that point in my life that I also suffered from all these digestive things that I'd never had before, too. I had all of this, like acid reflux came on. I went to the doctor and they tried to prescribe me like some pill that was gonna suppress the acid in my stomach. And I was just like, wait a minute. I need to go talk to somebody that's a little bit more holistic and can kind of zoom out. And so I went to an herbalist and a naturopathic doctor, and both of them were like, well, when did all this start? And I was like, about 2 years ago. And they're like, well, what do you think changed? Anything? And I was like, well, I became a vegetarian. And they're like, okay. So like you spent your whole life, you know, eating a variety of things, and then you just like took one thing out of your diet, and maybe it might make sense to start eating a little bit of meat, like, you know, grass-fed organic meat if you can. And I was challenged by that because I knew how meat was raised in mass production, and I was a college student. I didn't have like money to buy all this organic meat that's really expensive. So, but I started just integrating a little bit more if I could, you know, a couple times a week, and eating more fish. And I would say within like 2 months, all of my symptoms disappeared, and I was just like, what happened? Like, you know, I started taking herbs as well from an herbalist and got really interested in health and wellness, and started studying herbalism, studying holistic medicine and alternative therapies to diet and, you know, not, because like I was offered pharmaceuticals. And so I was like, well, that isn't a direction that I wanted to go at age, you know, 20, to be on some pill that I might have to be on the rest of my life. So zoom forward, spent about 8 years studying herbal medicine with Chris Morano of Clearpath Herbals, and Jade Alessandro Mace of Milk and Honey Herbs, and Brittany Nickerson of Time Herbal. And within those several years, I experimented a lot on myself with like different foods, different herbs, learning how to grow them. And it wasn't really until I started practicing, like seeing clients and mostly my friends and family, you know, just like starting out, I was like, you know, there's something to this, like looking at the whole person, zooming out and asking individuals questions that you have time with people more than like the 5-10 minutes that a doctor might have. And then I went to a yoga center for a few months to study Ayurvedic medicine and yoga. And that's when I discovered ghee, which is clarified butter. And the whole, has anybody ever heard of like ketogenic diets and bulletproof diet and paleo? And it's eliminating basically beans and simple carbs and sugar from the diet, and then introducing a lot more healthy fats. So I experimented with all of that. I can't say that I like stick to any one thing because I'm not disciplined in that way, and I love to eat all different kinds of things. But it was really on that path for myself of trying these different diets and herbs that I discovered the benefits of eating healthy fat, and that there's a lot of myths out there around fat. Curious, like, if what you all think about fat when you hear the word, what you were told maybe as a kid, or what you think now when you hear the word fat. What do you, anybody got any ideas? Yeah?
We were like kind of taught that fat is bad.
Yep. Yeah. The fat-free movement, like all of the products that used to say, some still do, like fat-free, 1% milk, fat-free milk. And what do you think kind of replaced the fat? Because fat tastes really good. So what came in to replace fat? Yeah.
Sugar.
Yes. Yeah. So taking out fat, the things don't taste as good. So sugar went in. Another reason why, you know, sugar was added was because of large corporations producing a mass amounts of sugar, and it tastes great. Sugar tastes, you know, sugar and fat together is like primo. So putting those together and getting people basically hooked on sugar is a way to, I think, kind of control society, because you get hooked on a food and then you want to buy more of it. And sugar actually is not very good energy for the body, unless you're maybe like an athlete running, like my sister's a ultra marathon runner, and she goes to GCC, and she just like chugs sugar things, like packets of sugar as she's running. And I'm like, that's like to keep her going for 31, 50 miles, you know? That seems okay, because her body's just gonna like burn it up in like a few minutes. But she also chugs fat. Like, she'll get little packets of, like, I don't even know what's in it, to be honest. You've probably all seen them before. They're like little things that you just kind of take as you're running, and it's like caffeine, fat, and sugar. So anyway, back to healthy fat. Any other, like, ideas that you heard about fat? Oils? Yeah.
So my big thing growing up was fat-free milk or skim milk. I didn't drink that horrible stuff. And I'm now learning and teaching that that's not such a great idea necessarily.
Yeah. Yeah. So I also grew up with that. My grandmother is deathly afraid of fat. She's a Jewish grandmother. Anything with fat in it is like, stay away. There's fat-free cream cheese, fat-free milk, fat-free cheddar cheese, like. And the stuff doesn't taste like anything to me. It just tastes kind of like cardboard. And so I'll go to her house and I'll be like, why don't you eat an avocado? Like, oh my God, there's so much fat in avocados. And she's so afraid of it. Meanwhile, she's got arthritis. She has all these aches and pains. And you know, she spent her whole life avoiding being fat. And now she's suffering from osteoporosis and osteopenia. And so it's just the correlation between the fat-free movement, which got everybody hooked on carbs and sugar, is actually not real nourishment. So there's actually 9 calories to every 1 gram of fat, whereas carbs and sugar there's about, you know, 2 to 4 calories. And that means that fat is actually going to sustain you and give you more energy throughout the day. So starting your day off with like a bowl of cereal and fat-free milk, that's like, if I ate that, I'd be hungry like within an hour. You know, I would have like that, you know, that feeling maybe without coffee where you start your day and then like an hour later you're like kind of tired and drained and hungry. And the sugar and carbs just like spiked you for a half hour or so. And then as soon as that left your bloodstream, it's like psh, back down, and you need like some more sugar or something to keep going. I've been on that cycle in my life. And then when I cut that out, my weight like never changed. I haven't changed weight in like 10, 15 years. It's always been the same. And I eat so much fat, like probably more than I should. But yeah, so that idea that was instilled in me by my grandmother and just general society, like I would eat an orange like one day and think that that was going to help me lose weight. Meanwhile, I'm just exhausted and angry and crabby and like, and I remember specifically like this one moment at the beach where my, we had like fat-free potato chips or something. And my mom just looked at me and she's like, Hannah, why are you eating fat-free potato chips? And I was like, I don't know. I was like, I don't want to get fat. And she's like, you don't have to worry about that. Like you're active, you know, like you actually need fat. And I was like, huh, okay. So that's kind of what got me onto this whole journey with starting Full Moon Ghee and making, now we're making about 800 pounds a month of ghee and selling it locally. And so I'm going to get a little bit into what the different kinds of fats are. If you have questions along the way, just ask them. I think there's a mic, right? You have a mic? And you probably know a lot more about like the chemistry and science of fat than I do. I have more of like the holistic health background. I just started looking up like chemistry of fat for this class, and it was fascinating. And I was also like, you know, I didn't study food science. I studied holistic health. So it was just like a whole other world opening up of all these diagrams of hydrogen and oxygen molecules. But so the myth of fat is that fat will not make you fat unless you're eating trans fats, which, do you guys know what trans fats are? So where do you find trans fats?
Processed foods.
Yep, processed foods. Anywhere else? Yeah, like junk foods. Yeah. Hydrogenated oils, like peanut butter sometimes has hydrogenated oil in it to give it that like creamy texture. It stays semi-solid. Anywhere else do you find them? Fried food? Yep. Just anywhere, like the fast food nation, there's all these really cool documentaries about like Michael Moore did a documentary about Super Size Me and all the fast food industries, which is always fascinating to watch. His documentaries are kind of a riot. So another myth about fat is that, that it'll make you fat and that it'll raise your cholesterol, right? So if you have heart disease or have high cholesterol, fat will make your cholesterol increase. That's a whole like complex other thing that we'll get a little bit into, but everybody over a certain age is now being tested for cholesterol. You can even do it now. And I don't know what percent, but a lot of people are on cholesterol lowering medications. And does anybody know like what cholesterol does, the different kinds? So there's the good cholesterol, the bad cholesterol. What does the good cholesterol do? Mm-hmm. It like helps create cells. Yep. Yep. Anything else?
cholesterol. It helps like remove the bad of cholesterol.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it helps balance. Yeah. It also is, it produces hormones. So it helps to regulate hormones of the body. The liver helps to produce cholesterol. And so if you don't have enough of the good cholesterol, there can be hormonal imbalances, which can later in life for women cause a lot of challenges when going into menopause. Can for younger women cause disruption in the menstrual cycle. So we really need cholesterol, the good cholesterol. And what about the bad cholesterol, LDL? What does that do? Yeah.
Excess levels of it can kind of block up arteries.
Yep. Which is what we hear a lot about, right? Everything on TV is like the bad cholesterol is like, you know, it causes heart disease, which it does if we have too much of it. So things that trans fats do is they increase the LDL cholesterol and they decrease HDL. So they can cause heart disease and which is one of the number one causes of death in the U.S. So there's a few other kinds of fat. There's also saturated fats. Do you know where those come from?
Mm-hmm. Butter has fat,
yep. Butter, animal products, beef, red meat, tallow, and lard. You know, my grandmother used to make pies with lard, which was probably healthier than the Crisco she ended up using later on, because Crisco is a little bit more processed and mysterious to me. So, yep, we have saturated fats that comes from animal products. Ghee is saturated fat. It's a little bit of both unsaturated and saturated. So how do you know if it's saturated? Is that at room temperature, it's solid. Like coconut oil is solid. Ghee is solid at room temperature. Tallow and lard would be solid. And it's actually more stable than unsaturated fat. So it'll last longer on the shelf than unsaturated fat. Like an unsaturated fat would be olive oil because it's liquid. So it's a mono unsaturated fat. And vegetable oils, those are liquid. So they have all oils have about a year shelf life for eating. You could use them topically after a year, but eating, you really don't want to eat an oil that's been sitting out a year. It can go rancid, and fats are just harder to break down and become toxic if they're over a year old. So saturated fat also has a very high smoke point, which means that you can cook like 350 to really 450 degrees or so. So ghee has like a 485 degree smoke point. If you're learning to cook, it's more forgiving because it won't burn. Whereas butter is a little lower in like the 300s because it has the milk and water in it, so it'll still burn. Olive oil is a monounsaturated fat, and it shouldn't be heated really at all, like over 180 degrees. It'll start to smoke, and when it starts smoking, it kind of becomes burned, and it just doesn't even taste good, you know? It's like, I think it just kind of becomes like carcinogenic because you're burning oil, and if it doesn't taste good, why eat it? I once made like a salve for your skin, and I soaked all these herbs in olive oil, and they felt really nice, and then I heated the oil up to add beeswax to it. I burned the crap out of it, and it just like smelled like I was putting fried food on my hands, so I threw out the whole batch. But yeah, that's the way I learned that olive oil is not the best for skin products unless you don't overheat it. But I don't like the way olive oil feels anyway. And then there's polyunsaturated fats, like nuts and seeds, walnuts, fish. And all of those, monounsaturated, polyunsaturated, nuts, seeds, fish, avocados, and like sardines would be in there. Those are healthy fats. So you can eat as much as you want of those kind of fats, I think. And some people will say to have 50 to 70% of your diet be fat. You can get more bang for your buck. You get more energy, less brain fog, great for the neurological system. The brain is mostly fat, 60% fat. So I think of fat as like these healthy ones and not so much the trans fat. Saturated fat, you can, I think you can eat a lot of it if you're active, but if you're working at a desk all day or in school a lot and sitting a lot, you know, eating a little bit less saturated fat. If you have heart disease, maybe eating a little bit less saturated fat. If you have high cholesterol, not eating too much of the saturated fat. But the other ones, you can have as much of as you want. And then there's essential fatty acids. What are those? Do you know about what's an omega-3 fatty acid? That's one of them, yep. CLA, conjugated linoleic acids, yep. And that's in ghee, that's in butter, coconut oil. Those are, I think, medium chain triglycerides. Or, yeah, you probably know more than me about all those things. What else is a omega-3? See them like in the store, on the shelf, in these packages, and it says omega-3s all over it now. Mm-hmm. Yep. So fish oil, flaxseed oil, eggs, that's a big one. So eggs kind of got a bad rap because they were coming from chickens that were being fed corn and soybeans and not getting free range outside, not eating green things and proteins. So if you're eating eggs, they ought to be coming from somewhere that they're being raised outside humanely. I think you can eat as many eggs as you want if they're raised well. So I have chickens and I probably eat like two eggs a day probably. So, and I've never had like high cholesterol or anything like that. So that's kind of another myth. Maybe if you're eating like 10 eggs a day, that would be an issue, but who wants to do that anyway? So eating omega-3s is actually balancing to the body. It balances cholesterol. Then there's omega-6s, which are more from like vegetable oils. So you don't want to eat too many vegetable oils, primarily because a lot of them are processed through chemical solvents. So unless it says cold pressed, expeller press is okay? Yeah, expelling. But if they don't have any like information about how they're made, it could be a chemical solvent, which I don't think you want to do. Organic and non-GMO is best because there's a lot of chemicals that go into growing things like canola and vegetables that, but I think the more processing that's going on, the less you want to eat it because there's a lot behind the scenes. Whereas because we live in New England, I tend to think it's important to eat local as much as possible wherever you are. So although I love coconut oil, it doesn't really grow around here. I've been trying to think like what's the most local oil that I can get. And you can get like sunflower oil. There used to be a sunflower oil company local. But ghee really is the most local thing because we have cows in New England. And ghee comes from butter, which has to be refrigerated. if kept more than like 60 days. So if you turn it into ghee, which is through just cooking it down, very natural process, and all of the milk and water separates out, and then we strain out the milk, it becomes shelf stable. It lasts about a year, and it it doesn't have to be refrigerated at all. So ghee is kind of the only local oil that I've come across that we have potential to produce on a larger scale. But then there's the whole farming cow thing that is a whole other topic, because there's not very many dairy farmers left that are making butter. So that's a whole other class though. Let's see. So let's talk a little bit. Are there any questions before I get into more of the benefits of fat? No? Okay. So I tend to think of fat, like, when I looked up fat online, it's like a chemical, you know, I'm like, okay, that doesn't work for me. But in the way that I was taught about fat is that it is what's called sattvic in Ayurvedic medicine. So it's softening, it's calming, it's nourishing, relaxing. It is kind of like the mother of food in a way. It's like, you know, the mother's milk, the deep nutrition, oil for your car. Like, you can't drive your car without oil in it. So if you don't have any fat, what happens is the engine seizes up, everything dries out, your car is not going to drive without oil in it. There's going to be smoke, and it will, I've had that happen. You'll be on the side of the road, and you're not going anywhere. It will, in the body, if you don't get enough fat, digestion can slow down. There can be constipation. I think a lot of people are constipated, partially with what we're eating, but also just not eating enough good fat, not drinking enough water. The bowel movement system really needs a lot of water to eliminate. So eating really good fats the night before can help relieve constipation in the morning. Like, in Ayurvedic medicine, they'll recommend drinking like a tablespoon or two of ghee at night, and then that'll promote regular bowel movements in the morning. So it's like the internal lubrication of the body. It helps to lubricate the joints. So if you have arthritis, if you're an athlete and you have like, just, you know, your knees are aching, your neck, your back, it's kind of just like this fluid moving substance in the body. And what else? So the other thing that fats do is that it insulates the body. So if you feel cold, like when I was a vegetarian, I was cold all the time. And we live in New England where it's cold 6 months out of the year. And so, we bundle up and everything, but I think having a nice, like, in the winter, I often get like a nice little extra bundle around me, and I'm like, that's cool, because I'm not going to be as cold. And I'll burn it off in the spring when I'm outside more. So it actually insulates the body more from cold, so you might get sick less, because it boosts the immune system. Your organs will be more protected. The organs like to be, like, your organs are like, some of those, they're essential to your body. Like, if you don't have your liver, if you don't have your heart, gallbladder, you can live without your gallbladder. But those like to be, like, inside something soft. And so without, like, not having enough fat, those organs are going to be more exposed. It's kind of like, the way ghee is described to me, or fat, is that it's like a hug from your mother. It's just like, it wants to be kind of, like, around you and protect you. So yeah, and I like that. It makes me feel better about the body too. So, the other thing about fat is that it just makes things taste better. Like, if you make rice and then you just eat like plain, dry, white rice, it's like, it's good, but if you just like drizzle some butter on there afterwards, like, or even olive oil. It's so much better, way more delicious. And the body can't produce its own essential fatty acids. So back to like the eggs fish and flaxseed oils. I don't need a ton of flaxseed because I just don't like the taste, but you can get it through eggs. Like those things our bodies just don't make on our own. So it's important that we're eating enough of them. And I think that back to like the way in which fat is like the mother, it's like when we're stressed out and running around, they call it, in Ayurvedic medicine, that'd be like vata. So that'd be a lot of like wind and air and movement and kind of scattered. Do you ever feel like when you're on the computer for too long, like 3 to 4 hours, it's like the mind just gets kind of like frazzled and fried and you're like, oh my gosh, like I don't even know why I'm on the computer anymore. I've been looking at Facebook for 3 hours and I just came on to like post this thing about what I had for breakfast, you know? Like, it's just, that's what I call vata. It's like, you don't know why you're there anymore, and you suddenly find yourself in this space of, like, confusion and frazzlement, or, like, you've been doing errands for too long, driving around, and you get back to your house, and it's just, like, exhausted. So that's when I think fat is kind of balancing to vata. So it's that calming, soothing, it coats the nerves. It calms wind in the body, that frazzledness feeling. It calms like tics and tremors of the body. So it's just like really soothing. And of course you can have too much, but if you're moving around and you're staying active throughout the day, you know, I wouldn't worry about eating too much fat. I think our bodies actually need more fat than we're giving them often. So, you know, with our culture being kind of obese in many parts of the country, and I look at people that are very overweight and I feel so sad because there's so much malnourishment happening. It's like, it looks like they're overnourishing, but really underneath it all, there's lack of nourishment. The body's not assimilating the nutrients. It's not using its natural intelligence to digest the food. There's so much inflammation in the body. And a lot of that is due to sugar and simple carbs. So putting sugar and carbs together is just a recipe for inflammation, which is a whole other class about how to eat to eliminate inflammation. So what I wonder often is like, what is the deeper hunger? So what's underneath all of that is, I mean, from my experience is, I grew up in a house where at night we would all sit around TV and eat ice cream and just like kind of numb our feelings away. And so we used food to numb ourselves. My mom grew up with that. She was raised on formula milk, which was full of sugar. And so she has sugar cravings. And it's just like, it's this perpetual kind of family thing that I watched growing up. And it wasn't until I could move out of their house that I could see what was going on. And then as soon as I go back into my parents' house, I'm like looking in the cabinets for sugar. It's just so fascinating, the patterns of the body. Like, and then I'm like, why am I? I'm like staring in the refrigerator, like it's a TV. I'm like looking for something. And then I just like sit down and I'm like, where am I? Why am I doing that? It's like it all comes back into like the remembering this pattern of like food is comforting. And I absolutely think that food is pleasurable. It's probably one of the biggest pleasures of my life is eating. And I kind of base my entire day around it. So I like grocery shop for fun and I love cooking. But it's that like balance of when is food becoming more of like a numbing agent? Like what are you reaching for? Is it salty things? Is it sugary things? So where can you find real nourishment? And it wasn't until I was kind of like out of the house, out of my parents' house and out of college that I was like, oh, it's in connection with people. Like, you know, what I'm really craving underneath all of this sugar craving is deeper connection. And so it's been a journey to find that in life, is receiving nourishment from friends and community and different ways I can connect with my partner. And just so in that, it's fine to eat, like, I mean, I eat chocolate like every day, but when I'm reaching for things, I question myself sometimes, like, is this something I need? Or is this something I'm avoiding, you know? And it's just a practice. You don't have to get, like, super, you know, I don't know. Yeah, I know, it's like, if you start feeling bad about what you're eating, it's, like, not helpful. So when I'm eating, like, a cookie and I'm really loving it, that's very different than eating a cookie and then feeling bad about it while I'm eating the cookie. I think it actually, like, is more nourishing to just enjoy what you're doing and be present with it than, like, eat the cookie and then be like, oh, man, it's kind of just, like, I'm not going to be able to get out of bed tomorrow morning. I shouldn't have eaten that. You know, if you're going to, like, eat for pleasure, eat for pleasure. But if it becomes, like, a pattern of escape, it's like, oh, good to notice that. So we've got a couple more minutes, and then I want to take some questions and see if there's anything else. I did give you guys a little recipe back here on the last page of the handout. Usually when I teach this class, I'm like cooking and making ghee as I'm doing it. So today I was like, I wonder what'll happen if I'm not like doing something, you know, making ghee. But so this is a recipe for what are, it can be like truffles or energy bites or bliss balls. They're called ojas. So like ojas means vigor and energy and like deep nourishment in Ayurveda. So these are packed with really nourishing foods as medicine, and they kind of replenish the body after stressful situations or working all day or physically exerting yourself. And the main thing holding them together is fat. So you could use coconut oil or butter or ghee. And then the cacao in them is a nice energy boost as well. So this is a recipe that I'll make like a bunch of them, because throughout the day I'll just like get hungry and reach for bread. Or if I have these things already made up as snacks, then, you know, maybe I'll eat ojas truffles instead and have sustained energy instead of the, like, the sugar bread carb crash right after eating it, you know, a half hour later, and then reach for something else. So it's all about, I think, balance and eating, as you know, in, like, moderation. So, yeah.
Hannah, could you define Ayurveda?
Yeah.
And also talk about ghee versus regular butter and maybe the process?
Sure. So Ayurvedic medicine is one of the most ancient traditions of alternative medicine, or what I would call traditional medicine. It comes from India, and my background is more in Chinese medicine, so I've never been trained as an Ayurvedic practitioner, but more of a Chinese philosophy, but it's very similar because it's like an Eastern philosophy, and it's looking at the whole person, and it's looking at the different constitutions of each person or doshas, and there's vata, which we talked a little bit about, that air, and then there's pitta, which is water and fire. So pitta person, like, I've got a lot of pitta, like my face is probably a little red right now, and I have a lot of energy throughout like the day, and then I kind of crash at night. But and then there's kapha, which is, I also have a lot of kapha, is like more watery and earthy. So like a slower, like a cow is really kapha. So ghee is very kaphic, it's actually tridoshic, but when you make ghee from cow milk, it's very calming, it's soothing. People that are more kapha tend to be like a little bit heavier and a little slower and more calm, and maybe not just like rise to the occasion every chance they get, like go out and do something. You know, might prefer to like sleep in a little bit. And Vata is usually like a lot more thin and tall and can be like so absorbed into something and then lose focus and like, oh, why am I doing this? And so it's not really about like we're all one, like we're one thing or not the other, because we have all of the doshas inside of us. And it's more about like balancing them. And so there's not like excess of something and deficiencies in another. And ghee is actually tridoshic. It's balancing to all of the constitutions. And ghee is made from unsalted butter. So the way that I make it is different than it's made that I've seen in India, where they'll culture cream and cook it and ferment it a little bit so that it becomes kind of a cultured cream and sits for a few days, and then turn that into butter through, you know, making butter is through a churn, so that the buttermilk separates out, and then the fat is what stays, and that's what becomes the butter. So it's cream to butter, and then ghee is taking the butter and cooking that on like medium low heat until it turns kind of like golden brown and starts to smell a little bit like popcorn. And you don't want it to be on like super high heat because it could burn. And then about a half hour later, it, instead of having that like milky look to it, you can see to the bottom of the pan and it's starting to turn like a little brown on the bottom. And that's clarified butter. And then if you cook it a little bit longer, it gets kind of a, like a toasted nutty flavor, and all the water will evaporate out. So without the water in there, it's shelf stable, whereas the water in the oil, it could go rancid. And a lot of people don't cook it quite long enough, so it'll sit out on their counter and then can, you know, grow like little mold or something. At that point, you strain it through like a sieve or a little cheesecloth, and it's this clear, like liquid gold oil, and then you let it cool and use it for any cooking, really. I like it because it doesn't have a coconut flavor, it doesn't have an olive flavor, it's just like a butter flavor, really. So you can use it to make eggs and greens and roast vegetables. It doesn't have to be refrigerated, so I'll just leave it on the counter and use it for everything, really. And the other thing about ghee is that it's tridoshic, like any dosha can benefit from it. So no matter your body, if you're more kapha and have high cholesterol and maybe heart disease, as with any saturated fat, I wouldn't recommend eating like tablespoons at every meal, but a little bit won't hurt. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Any questions? Well, the difference, I guess, would be that it doesn't have milk in it, so it's lactose-free. You know, you don't, if you have a lactose intolerance or dairy allergy, after straining out all of the milk, it shouldn't bother you. I would, if you have a casein allergy, I would try a little bit of ghee before eating too much of it, because some people are just really sensitive to casein and may not be all of it removed. Casein is a protein in butter and dairy. And it tastes very similar. I think it tastes better than butter, but that's a really big claim, because butter tastes pretty good. And it doesn't have to be refrigerated. So you could, I mean, butter, it will, you could sit out butter on your counter for like a week or something, but without salt in it, it can start to go bad. So it, ghee is just a little more shelf stable. You can travel with it, you can camp with it. you don't have to have a refrigeration system when you have a business, which is really nice to not have a food that has to be in a refrigerator. Does that answer your question about the difference between ghee and butter? Yeah.
Is also ghee a solid?
Yeah. I brought a jar for Susan, and it's just like a solid. There's at 85 degrees, it'll melt. It'll be kind of like, it'll just look like golden, you know, melted butter. But at this temperature, we're at like, you know, 65, 70 degrees, it's totally solid and similar to coconut oil. And that's where you know it's a saturated fat. Like if it were liquid at this temperature, then it would be more of like unsaturated fats. It's about half and half, half saturated, half unsaturated. And you want both in the body. The whole saturated fat is terrible for you was a study that this guy Ansel Keys did that he didn't actually finish the data. He didn't complete the study and it all went out and got published that fat was bad for you, which I think was probably done by the industrial food system because they wanted to get on the sugar train. And then later they came out and said that was actually false information, that wasn't true. We do need saturated fat in our body, so yeah. Yeah.
The third one, you said that the one is like kind of like a more attention.
Vata?
And then, oh, okay.
Yeah.
And then the other one was like a sleep in.
Kapha.
And then what was the third?
And pitta.
And what's pitta?
Pitta is more fire and water, so maybe has like, wakes up in the morning and is like, oh my God, I have this to do and that to do, I'm gonna go do this and I'm gonna do that. Like just a lot of energy. Maybe have like red in the face and. Just want to be busy and doing things, maybe more prone to anger. These are like, I wouldn't say judgments, just like observations, and they're all different depending on the person too.
Okay.
Yeah.
And ghee is just like better than butter for all three of those people? Is butter like specifically bad for one?
Butter would be challenging more for people that are kapha because it has the dairy in it, the milk, and milk can create mucus in the body. And kapha tends to be like, you know, this time of year with spring coming, I have like more of a runny nose, and that's a kapha indication that there's dampness in the body. So kapha is a little more damp, heavier, slower. And so when I have like a runny nose throughout the day, I'll try to add like cinnamon to my oatmeal instead of just plain oatmeal and butter, you know. And that cinnamon is warming and will help to kind of warm things up and expel the dampness in the body. Yeah.
And did you say that, I kind of missed the beginning, I mean, did you say you use ghee topically or just
topically? Yeah, you could use ghee topically. I've seen products with ghee in it. There's like some face creams out there and I find that it's really nice as a lip balm. So if I'm like, don't have lip balm on me and just use ghee, but you can smell a little like buttery and cheesy afterwards, so it's not my go-to. But there's a company that buys ghee from me to make like a face cream, which sounds, it looks really nice, but I've never tried it. Yeah. And in India, they say that as the ghee gets older, like it actually is like better for your skin topically. And that it helps with burns. So if you get like a burn in the kitchen or a sunburn, ghee is cooling, hydrating, moisturizing, will help to like expel the heat. Although in the body, it can help rev up digestion, which is just really interesting that it has these many different effects depending on how you use it. Yeah. Yeah, Susan.
Would you mind passing that around?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you can open it if you don't mind. I wanted to give it to you, but yeah. Yeah. Any other questions?
Do you actually make it on the full moon?
We do make it on the full moon. Yeah. Yeah, I make the ghee on the full moon. It's traditionally made on the waxing moon or when the moon is getting larger because a couple reasons that in India, they'll say it's the time when there's a lot more vitality and energy in the grass that the cows are eating, because it's being pulled upward by the moon, because the moon pulls on water, which is in everything. So making ghee from animals, from cow butter that has been eating that high vibration, high energy going upward, creates a product that you can then eat throughout the month to increase your energy and vitality. And then in like biodynamic farming, similar thing, like the moon is pulling on the grass, or the water in the grass, and so it's just like has more juice in it. And then I asked if what would happen if you make it on the full moon, and this woman looked at me and she said, oh, it's very auspicious. And so I continued making it on the full moon. And it is. It's making something on the full moon has its ups and downs. Like some moons, because they're all so different. Like last month, the last new full moon was on the 20th, and we made it, and it was really, it went super well. And I follow astrology a little bit, and I guess like in the, you know, in where it was in the cosmos was like a really high productive, good, like flowing energy moon, and good for your business financially. And other months, it's like everything breaks when we're making it. Sometimes like all of the, like the labeling machine doesn't work. And so it really depends on the moon, I think. But I'm just going with it. And we give ourselves like a few day window. So it's not, you know, when the kitchen I rent asks like, when do you want to make it on the full moon? How do I know when the moon is full? They were like, okay, well, I got them a moon chart. And I was like, can you just schedule us for the dates that it's the full moon? They were like, okay, whatever. So I just like to keep with the cycles of nature because that feels aligned for me. You know, there's so many pulls to get outside of nature in our society that any little piece of my business that can connect me more to where the food's coming from and the cycles of nature means a lot to me. And I think it goes into the food as well, I would hope. People get to eat it and feel nourished and healthy and vitality. Any other questions? Yeah.
In the like Ayurveda, are there any foods that you're not supposed to eat with fat?
With fat?
That like don't digest as well?
Really depends on the body type. So I was actually thinking about this on the way here was like some people have their gallbladders removed. So if you don't have a gallbladder, it makes it really challenging to digest fat. So you don't, it's like recommended not to eat too much fat. There might be some enzymes that you can take with the fat that help to digest it. But because it can be kind of heavy, and the one thing that I would recommend is to eat good fat with bitters, like leafy greens and lacto-fermented vegetables like sauerkraut and kimchi, kale, spinach, because bitters, dark greens, and, you know, like you can buy bitters in the store too, like little tincture bottles of dandelion root, and those to help stimulate the gallbladder to secrete juices to break down the fats. So if you're feeling like, Hannah told me to eat more fat, and I feel bloated and terrible and tired, and I don't think it's working for me. You know, maybe try eating a salad with salad dressing on it, as like olive oil as the base, or you know, always having a balance of greens with the fat, because the greens are going to help to rev up the gallbladder, which then will secrete enzymes and juices to break down fat. Does that answer your question? I feel like it kind of did. Yeah, and signs that like you might be eating too much fat, I would think is too loose of stools. So maybe like you're causing diarrhea, could be eating too much fat, and feeling like nothing's moving in your digestive system. And again, it depends on the kind of fat too. So you know, I'll eat like 2 tablespoons of ghee a day, but also have like olive oil and fish and nuts and seeds, and not solely relying on the saturated fats. Any other questions?
Yeah. Just fat, what would you say would be like, say if you were doing like a, I don't know, like a ketogenic diet or something, where it's based solely on fat? What would be like a good ratio for like saturated, poly, mono? Obviously, saturated would be the most because it's the most abundant. But
yeah, so for a ketogenic diet, well, what I've like seen and read, I haven't been on like a full ketogenic diet before, but the guy who helped me like found Full Moon Ghee is like super into ketogenics and paleo, and every day had like the newest study, and he would start his day with bulletproof coffee. So he would make coffee and add coconut oil, ghee or butter, and then MCT oil. And I really do think there was like 3 tablespoons, maybe 4, of just like fat sitting in the coffee. And then he'd blend it. You blend it with like a immersion blender or Magic Bullet. And that would be his meal until like 10 or 11. So what he would do is try to switch his body over from burning carbs and sugar for energy to burning fat, because it's more efficient for the body. And then, you know, having like salad and fish and a lot of avocados when he was doing the ketogenic thing, like so many avocados, so much fish, so much greens and veggies and sweet potatoes, but not white potatoes, and no rice and no beans, and then always drizzling like oil on that. And if you find you're getting cold, that's a sign that you're not like getting enough warm foods, and so you might want to try eating like you know, chicken or beef or lamb, something like pork, something that'll warm you up more, because I think eating like totally raw in the winter is not a good idea, because it's just so cold. Like we need warm cooked foods, and then dinner would be like burger and greens. And I found that like when I would do the eliminating all of the carbs and the sugars, is that I felt like I had more sustained energy throughout the day. Didn't have these like spikes of energy of like, oh, I want a coffee at 4 o'clock, you know? Like that would be really nice to get me through. And instead it was like I could tell when I was hungry. Whereas with sugar and carbs, I get when I'm hungry, or when I'm not really hungry, I'm just having like mood swing kind of. Like it's more up here. Whereas on the ketogenic diet, when I've tried it, it's like I can feel the hunger in my stomach. Like you get the hunger pains. And it was important to have snacks, otherwise I would want to eat like whatever I could find. And that lasted for like a couple weeks. And then after a couple weeks, I felt like my blood sugar started to balance more, and I didn't have as many cravings, and I didn't get this like wave of, oh my God, I'm so hungry. And then it kind of balanced. And people tend to lose a lot of weight when they do ketogenics. So just be careful if you're already, you know, thin or underweight, then, you know, may not be the thing for you, or just eat enough meats and stuff. Yeah, and with any diet, it's like, I just think it's all about knowing your body. And it's an experiment. And so I know what works for me and I know it doesn't. And like the vegetarian thing did not work for me. And then depending on the time of the year too, like doing a lot of salads and like smoothies when it's negative 10 degrees outside feels terrible, because I'm like freezing cold. I definitely don't want a smoothie. And then I went to like Hawaii a couple weeks ago and I was like, smoothies? Yes. Like it's 85 degrees. I want a smoothie. And then I felt like that was appropriate. But then coming back, it's like, okay, back to soups and, you know, warm foods. So experiment, like listen to your body. I always just like kind of see how I feel afterwards, and it changes. And it's like really creating a relationship with yourself and what feels good and what doesn't. And then I find if I've done the like some diet that's really clean, and then I go back to eating, like, you know, go out and get like fried fish and like French fries. I call it like dumping mud into the clean river. So it's so much more obvious when I'm eating really clean and then eating a bunch of junk how it makes me feel. Because if the river is already really muddy and then you dump some more mud in, it's like, eh, maybe don't notice. But if your river's really clean and clear and then you dump mud in, it's a little more noticeable because you can see the mud. So that's always the like fun part of doing a like healthy eating, is when you start introducing those foods again and it's like, whoa, it's not really worth eating that because now I like can't get out of bed in the morning. I'm exhausted and my stomach hurts and I'm farting. So.
What's your diet?
My diet?
Yeah.
Depends. Yeah. I would say
like when, you're here.
When I'm here in the winter, it's a lot of like soups and stews and rice, and I really love like tacos and Mexican food in the winter. I don't know what it is, but I'm eating like rice and beans and cheese and avocados and cilantro like every meal. But then as it warms up, it's like I'll eat more lightly cooked foods, a lot of onions and like garlic to kind of rev up the liver to promote detox. And it fluctuates. Like, I know that when I eat like a bagel and cream cheese for breakfast, I'm hungry like an hour later. Even oatmeal, I can't eat oatmeal because I'll be like hungry within an hour. And as long as I eat a lot of protein, so I'll eat like eggs for breakfast, you know, like chicken and greens and rice for lunch. And I probably eat meat like every day. Yeah. Yeah. Like fast foods and French fries and things?
Yeah. Like fast food or just like, not processed, but even like bacon or something. Like something that's like super, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
Oily.
Do I stay away from oily foods? So it depends on the oil. Like if it's French fries from a restaurant, I don't know what oil it's being cooked in. It's a lot of like palm oil, peanut oil, soy oil. And those don't tend to feel really good in my body. And they taste really good going in, but then I just like don't feel great an hour later. I wouldn't say I'm like strict, you know, like I think I'm alive here on this planet and I love French fries at times, but it's not something I'll eat like every day. And then oils, like, you know, I had bacon and eggs and like butter on toast this morning. Like I had a lot of protein, a lot of fat and meat for breakfast. And that was 4 or 5 hours ago and I'm like still not that hungry. So something that like has balance of like, you know, some grains, some protein, some fat, that'll sustain me for much longer than if I had like a smoothie for breakfast of fruit and greens and then I'd probably be like, oh my God, when is this class gonna end? Because I have to go eat, you know? But it depends on the season too. Yeah. Did that answer your question? Yeah. Any other questions?
Thank you, Hannah.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thanks for having me.